So, good evening, people. Welcome to the Keter-Hamburger Dialogue this evening. This is our 11th Keter-Hamburger Dialogue from the Center for Global Cooperation Research here at the University of Duisburg-Essen. My name is Jan-Art Scholte. I'm co-director of the center, and it's my pleasure to welcome you. The center is one of 10 Keter-Hamburger colleagues in Germany, funded by the German federal government, Ministry of Research and Education. The centers cover a number of different topics. This center covers the topic of global cooperation. It was founded in 2012 and is now in its second six-year phase of funding. We started the second phase in early 2018. The Keter-Hamburger dialogues are one of the main modes of knowledge exchange for the center. We invite experts in the field, our fellows, and the general public to come together and discuss burning issues of the day. And one of those burning issues is online defamation, prospects for global cooperation, resisting online defamation, which should emphasize. One of our core research interests at the center for this second phase is internet governance, one of the four policy fields that we concentrate on. Under internet governance, we cover the physical infrastructure of the internet, the virtual infrastructure of the internet, and that relates to today's session, the content that actually flows through the internet. So we will talk about that this evening. There is a briefing for you prepared by the staff on online defamation, which is very handily covers a number of the issues in terms of the topics, the terms, the targets, the laws and policy responses. So this is extremely convenient, and we thank Martin Wolf, as well as researchers Eva Maria Tröser and Daniela Weisskopf for putting this together. It's very helpful. Thanks also to Julia Fleck for organizing this event. The Center for Nano Integration for hosting us here today. Thanks to the IT team here for making the live stream possible and all. Thanks very much. That's a lot of extra effort. And thanks to you, audience, for being here. Then thanks to the panel, to whom I now hand over to Sigurd Kvak, who's the director of the center.
Okay, thank you very much, Jan. Welcome, everybody. Good evening. And welcome to our roundtable discussion on resisting online defamation prospects for global cooperation. So with this roundtable, we wish to explore what can be done against online defamation, which is on the rise globally in the internet. Online defamation is is one form of offensive expression in internet. It's a big topic, and its boundaries to hate speech and online harassment are fuzzy. And we are not pretending to stick closely to online defamation today. We chose it as a focus of the discussion. It's kind of the tip of the iceberg, but certainly the panelists will take their liberty to extend it as they consider fit. Online defamation can have also different meanings depending on historical, political, and legal context, which also raises challenges to, let's say, global solutions, and we will also speak about that. But no matter what specific form it takes, the spread of online defamation is part of a more general rise of aggressive, derogatory, and threatening forms of communication on the internet that target particularly minorities, women, and some professional groups, such as journalists, as also documented in our briefing. It's not only targeting and threatening individuals and social groups, but it's also a threat threatening to poison public debates, and therefore it raises questions of what can be done to resist. How can we establish rules, standards, and procedures that foster respectful rather than derogative speech in online public debates? How can we do this and keep still enough space for controversial debates? Given that providers of online platforms are global actors and that hate speech can easily travel globally, what is the role of global cooperation in governing content on the internet? How can one balance these two basic human rights, the human rights for freedom of expression, freedom of speech, and the right to protection against attacks on your honor and reputation? Especially given the multiple historical, political, and also cultural conditions around the world. To discuss these questions, we have invited four distinguished panelists, and allow me to introduce the panelists. So I start from the right to the left, and it's also in the order in which they will speak. Blaine Huggert is an associate professor of political science at Brock University in Canada, and he's currently a research fellow at the Karakar Center for Global Cooperation Research here at the University Duisburg-Essen. He is an expert on global political economy of knowledge and copyright. His 2014 book, Copyfight, investigates the global politics of digital copyright reform. Blaine is currently working on global knowledge infrastructures and the rise of government and commercial surveillance in the internet. And he will bring today to our discussion a focus on the role of American platforms and how they shape online discussions. So, Natasha Tusikov is an assistant professor in criminology at York University in Canada. She will be a fellow at our center in early summer next year, and in fact, she's investing some of her holiday to work very hard with us here on this panel, so thank you for that. Natasha is a specialist on global private regulation of the internet. Her recent book, Choke Points, at University of California Press 2017, examines how internet firms share personal information and the implications for private policies. She will talk particularly about the role of private platforms and suggest a strategy of deplatforming. Looking forward to that. Anna Shapkovskaya, to my left, is a postdoctoral research fellow at the Institute of East Asian Studies at the Universität Duisburg-Essen. She is participating in a claims project that examines forms of political claim making in five countries, including, I think, Germany, France, Brazil, China, and India. Anna is an expert on the transformation of political representation through digital technologies in China, and she is about to extend her studies with a comparative focus to Russia, and she is fluent in both languages, which is exceptional, right? So it allows her to really bring a non-Western perspective to this debate tonight. And last but not least, to my left, Danielle Flonk is research associate at the Hertie School of Governance in Berlin. She works on a project evolving internet interfaces, content control, and private protection. And her PhD dissertation project examines internet governance and the development of international norms with regard to content control in the internet. And she will tell us more about current European initiatives and their advantages, potentials, and limits to regulate offensive internet content. So welcome to all of you. We are very happy to have you here. Thanks for joining us in this roundtable discussion. So I suggest that we proceed as follows. We'll start with short opening statements in the order of how I introduce the speakers, followed by a roundtable discussion on cross-cutting issues here, and then we will open up to discussion with the audience. For those following us via live stream, there is an opportunity to send in questions to the panelists through the YouTube comment function as well as the Twitter hashtag resist hate speech. So please get involved because we really want you to participate here locally but also virtually, and feel free to send us comments. So I would like now to ask Blaine to start with his short statement, and then we go around, you know, the panelists, and then we get into discussion.
Okay. Thanks very much, Sigrid. I'll try to keep this short. So, online defamation. I'm very happy to be here talking about this topic. It's a very complex one, because of the overlapping scale of the problem. You have different groups and societies and countries all having different standards to what when it comes to what speech is considered acceptable or what is even considered to be free speech, and also, of course, the ability of individual communities or individuals or societies to fight back or withstand hate speech itself or online defamation. For example, myself, white, straight Canadian, my experience online is going to be different from someone who's a woman or indigenous or so on. Different people have different experiences. And the more marginalized you are, the more likely that, you know, the words spoken online or words written online or actions online are that they're likely to translate into negative effects offline. And on top of that, you have the particular global nature, not exactly of the internet itself, but of the social media sites that have become the world's public squares. And they're not really global in the sense of a decentralized transnational space, which is the way that I think we're kind of used to thinking about the internet. But instead, they really are outside of China and Russia, American for-profit companies financed by huge fortunes, the largest of which, Facebook, is accountable to only one person, Mark Zuckerberg, who controls, who has a majority control of the company. And so the problem of regulating online hate speech and disinformation and dealing with defamation, it's often presented as one of scale. You know, how can one company regulate the over 2 billion people on its platform, especially with all the conflicting domestic views on what's proper and what should be done? For instance, you know, in Canada, we kind of like free speech. We talk about free speech, but our conception of what that is different from our American neighbors, where the First Amendment of the U.S. Constitution has a very particular meaning. So if you've got two countries that are so similar with differing views on this, there's going to be problems if you try expanding, like, you know, for instance, a world court of Facebook to the entire world, which is essentially what Facebook and Mark Zuckerberg have proposed over the past month. And so on the one side, you've got that. On the other side, you have people who fear the balkanization of the internet, that separate regulation by different countries, you know, to actually respect the interests and values of the people in those actual countries would somehow inhibit the global spread of knowledge. Now, what I want to suggest in my opening comments is that these views kind of take for granted a whole number of issues that should be open to discussion and be open for public debate. And chief among these are, first, should for-profit companies be allowed to operate in this space? These are kind of basic questions that really need to be asked. You know, as we've seen, pursuing profit and growth don't always align if you want to kind of create a healthy online environment. So what would some of the alternatives, what should they be? Is competition among social media sites possible or desirable? Or is there something to be said for greater stability in this area? You know, I have some ideas myself about what this should be, and maybe we can talk about that in the question and answer. But for now, let's just say that there's a whole continuum of possibilities with respect to regulation and control between having amoral for-profit companies like Facebook driving things or authoritarian state control over your social media accounts, as in China, between a California internet and a Chinese internet, as French President Emmanuel Macron put it in a speech to the Internet Governance Forum in Paris last month. Now, I'll close my initial comments on the question of scale and the question of the metaphors that we use when talking about the global internet. Now, social media, really, it's not the only global sector in which we've seen negative cross-border spillover effects from negligent or criminal activity on behalf of a particular industry. I'm thinking back about 10 years to the 2008 global financial crisis. It started in the United States because of horrifyingly terrible regulation, domestic regulation, and spread around the world because of a combination of international capital flows and bad domestic regulation in the receiving countries, if you will. But the thing of it is, although we think of finance as a global system, countries differ dramatically in their willingness to regulate both capital flows and their domestic banking industries. And those that have strong, prudent regulation in the financial sector, such as, I'm happy to say, Canada, were spared the worst of the GFC, as were those that maintain capital controls on the finance flowing in and out of their borders. So I guess the question I'm asking is, what would social media look like if we thought of companies like Facebook as if they were banks? Would we be okay with one American-based company or one company based anywhere providing banking services around the world, or would we require them to set up wholly separate branches subject to domestic regulation? Or would we maybe want to promote interoperable nonprofit competitors? Or maybe perhaps we could come up with some kind of international agreement regulating the terms on which domestic social media interacts with the rest of the world, rather than leaving it up to the whims of a few companies and really a few people. I'm just going to put this down here and turn to my final page. What I'm suggesting is that if we want to get a handle on defamation and privacy issues related to social media, we need to get rid of the idea that we're stuck with a single model for running social media and that there's a single model of what constitutes the global. you know, algorithms are not the only way to scale justice, although they're the most effective and efficient if you're trying to govern 2 billion people. You know, they're not even a really good way for tackling the issue of defamation and hate speech. So instead, I think that we need to have a global and domestic governance conversation about social media that we've really avoided until now. I'll leave it there.
Good. Thank you very much, Blaine. And I think we move immediately on to Natasha, please.
Thank you. Well, I'm very pleased to be here to talk about the challenges and maybe some of the opportunities in regulating online defamation and hate speech. And this is because my research area really overlaps this. I look at the responsibilities and the limitations of platforms acting as regulators, both of their users and of the third-party content flowing over their platforms. And what I wanted to talk about tonight is the concept of deplatforming hate groups that's really gaining some momentum, especially in the United States, being pushed by civil society groups as a way to govern hate speech and hate groups in the United States. And this idea gained prominence in the United States after the violent white supremacist march in Charlottesville, Virginia, in August 2017 that resulted in the killing of a civil society activist. And it again raised, was considered much more prominent in the media after the Pittsburgh synagogue shooting in November 2018, in which that individual used Gab, a right-wing social media. And so what is deplatforming? Deplatforming is involves platforms actually removing their services from groups or individuals identified to be involved, in this case, in promoting violent hate. So this means that individuals or actors involved in using PayPal would lose their ability to fundraise. Those involved with Twitter or Facebook would lose the ability to spread their message. And recently in the United States, multiple groups, mostly white supremacist groups, have been deplatformed. And this, I wanted to start with the idea of deplatforming because it raises several important challenges. And I wanted to highlight three questions here. First, who designates these actors as worthy of being deplatformed? Who should be deplatformed, if anyone? So several prominent U.S. civil society groups are compiling lists of these hate groups to forward to platforms. And this raises the question, what role, if any, should government play in identifying or legitimizing these efforts of deplatforming? So my second major question is, what can platforms and what should platforms do in their responsibility for policing hate speech? And when we think about deplatforming, what platforms should be involved? Social media companies and web hosts are obvious choices for those who are supporters of deplatforming, but what about payment providers like PayPal? What about more technical platforms like domain registrars? What about security firms like Cloudflare that provide services to prevent DDoS or online attacks? And Cloudflare and domain registrars have been recipients of requests for groups to be deplatformed in the United States. Some have accepted those requests and some have denied them. And third, how effective are platforms in identifying and targeting actors responsible for promoting hate? We have an assumption that's very widespread in the public and among policymakers that these platforms are very accurate, very timely, very responsive regulators. And this assumption is not borne out in the research, including my book on platforms as regulators. And in fact, these platforms are relatively ill-equipped to distinguish legality from illegality online and often remove content wrongly, inaccurately. And a larger problem is that these companies have financial interests in gaining more users, in having more content be posted, no matter if it is toxic, and particularly because toxic content often is viral content, is very profitable content. And I wanted to begin with the idea of deplatforming to highlight broader issues regarding internet governance. And again, I'll highlight three issues. So first, we need to have regulation that suits local, cultural, political, and legal contexts. So Germany has different concerns than does Canada. We probably share a more common perspective than we do with the United States. And this means if we want to have global, local context or need to have local context, we have to push back against big, mostly US tech giants that want to have largely global standards instead of differing state standards. Second, we need to push back against the very prominent narrative that country-specific rules will lead to the balkanization or the fragmentation of the internet and leading to the weakening of technical standards. And this means that we have to consider the assertion of political boundaries online and perhaps country-specific platforms or region-specific platforms. And the serious troubles with Facebook, and we can point to the multiple troubles with Facebook now, really point a finger to how weak industry self-regulation is, how problematic relying on these platforms to police themselves is. And third, we need to bring back the state conceptually and empirically in this area. Of course, the state never really left, but this involves taking government seriously as an actor, as a key actor in internet governance, in terms of our scholarship and in terms of policy making. This also means critically re-examining ideas of our heavy reliance on industry self-regulation and some of the assumptions underlying multi-stakeholderism. It also means critically questioning some of the strong norms that underline the internet as we have now, particularly the US promoted norm of the global free flow of information. There are always rules governing information. There are always rules regulating speech. Who makes them and with what consequence are should be our key areas of inquiry. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Natasha. So we now move to Anna's account of China, a country where the state plays a quite different role.
Thank you very much. I'm very pleased to be here, and my task today is to provide a different perspective talking about China, and I will be talking about opportunities and challenges posed by internet in China. Well, in the last two decades, Chinese internet has rapidly expanded, and according to the recent statistics, there are over 700 million users in China. There are about 38 million platforms in China, which the number constantly growing, mainly stimulated by e-commerce, mobile e-paying, provisions of public services online, and so on. So this is a very massive sphere and rapidly growing sphere. From official rhetorics, we can see that China is determined to transform itself into a modern digital state. In particular, China has an ambition of becoming strong cyber superpower, and a frontrunner in high-tech digital technologies. The Chinese President Xi Jinping has been consistently emphasizing the importance of artificial intelligence and digital technologies. For example, in 2015, the Chinese government proposed the development strategy known as Internet Plus that promotes digitalization of economy, finance, manufacturing, social service provision, and so on. Most recently, one of the most hotly discussed topics are smart cities. So China is going to transform its cities into smart cities with the final target to transform its society into smart society. So internet provides a lot of opportunities and challenges, as I've just mentioned. Among opportunities, one outstanding one is, of course, the unprecedented opportunity to have a relatively autonomous field for individualized self-expression online. This is very important and rare in China. It also provides a sphere for expression of interest, underrepresented interests, grievances, and sentiments for ordinary people. So this is one of the most important opportunities internet provides to the Chinese society. There are, of course, a lot of challenges. For instance, an increasing number of cyber crimes, such as online fraud, scams, stolen identities, hacking banking accounts, theft of real money, as well as virtual assets, distribution of pornography, mass demoralization of youth by online gaming, fake news, personal data protection, cybersecurity, online promotion of terrorism, extremism, and separatism. And these are all very pressing issues that for the Chinese authorities. Similarly, defamation, of course, has become an issue that requires serious consideration in China also. Defamation defamation in China is criminalized and regulated by both civil and criminal codes. Defamation is defined as dissemination of false information with an intention to damage someone's reputation. By definition, therefore, defamation falls into several regulatory fields, such as information dissemination, slander, personal data protection, and constitutional rights for personal honor and dignity. Well, to address all above issues, the Chinese government has implemented several measures. For instance, in 2014, under the Central Committee of the Chinese Communist Party, the Central Leading Group for Cybersecurity was formed and headed by the President Xi Jinping. This means that previously fragmented regulation of cyberspace has become more centralized. Secondly, in 2013, party-led campaign to crack down fake news was launched on a nationwide scale, which is also important and ongoing nowadays too. Also, introduction of new regulations on distribution of mass information and criminalization of online illegal behavior. New regulations on legal responsibilities of tech companies, social media platforms managers, and individual internet users for dissemination of fake information, fake news or rumors, as they are called in China. Of course, the state has a very active role in all this. It aims at shaping the online discourses and online public opinion by discipline, but also by guidance. Therefore, for instance, the promotion of positive content over negative content is encouraged by authorities and also rewarded by the state. There are, of course, a lot of remaining problems that should be addressed. Fake news, of course, and defamation. Fake news and defamation are one of them. There are a lot of fake news on various different subjects. Another very outstanding problem is manhunt or human flesh searching engines, very serious problems that very often lead to suicides and different societal implications. The growth of nationalist sentiment also. So rather than talking about populism, for instance, we would rather speak of nationalist sentiments and nationalism in the Chinese cyberspace. Then the relatively well-structured and organized cyber crimes. So these are the cyber crimes that are no longer conducted by one single person, but by organized, structured group of people. For instance, one of the recent cases showed that the group of over 70 people were organizing cyber crimes online. For instance, from the recent statistics also, the average loss per person in China who become victims of cyber crimes is over 1,000 euros, which is a lot of money, of course. Of course, the byproducts of state involvement in the cyberspace management is growing censorship, accompanied by self-censorship and also by anti-censorship tactics. Another outstanding problem also is the general attitude of the people, of the common people, is that the internet is a lawless place. So basically, anything is possible. You should be careful. But if anything happens, you do not necessarily file a lawsuit, for instance, and solve the problems probably outside of the legal framework. So in terms of international cooperation, my statement would be that cooperation with China might be difficult, but it is possible. Most importantly, it is inevitable. So given the China's growing technological capacity and increasingly active international engagement with African countries, for instance, with Russia, for instance, the idea of non-engagement with China, with isolating China in the age of globalization and digitalization is no longer feasible. Rather, what is needed is a proper dialogue and cooperation. I will stop here. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Anna. And then we continue with Danielle, who will give us a European perspective.
Yeah, I also want to relate to the last issue that you addressed, namely the global cooperation against or with regard to content or hate speech or defamation. And I think there we have one main problem, and that is that the models of internet governance are too much diverging. So on the one hand, we already addressed a bit the US model, which is based on freedom of speech online, protected by the First Amendment. A lot of room is given to these private companies. That's one extreme. And then on the other extreme, there's China with a very internet, with the internet that's very much related, controlled by the state and related to the norm of information security. Information security is a term that a lot of authoritarian states use. They want to promote norms on these issues. And unlike cybersecurity, it's not just this idea that you have cybersecurity, but that you attach other issues with regard to content to it. So any content that would be harmful to social, political, and economic systems. So it's defined in a very broad way, and it's often seen as a Trojan horse for content control. And so there are these two extremes. And then somewhere in the middle, there's the EU, where freedom of speech, of course, is protected, but not as extreme as in the US. And companies, there's more distrust towards companies in the EU than there is in the US. And we see that the European Union is increasingly moving away from the US, especially when we look at content like hate speech, disinformation. For instance, this year there has been a recommendation on measures to effectively tackle illegal content online. There has been a code of conduct with intermediaries on countering illegal hate speech online. So you see that the EU is increasingly regulating the internet. So because there are so many diverging views, I think a global agreement would be very difficult. There would be no consensus, for instance, on a UN level. Especially because I think with the democratic, more Western country coalition, there's a fear that a content regime would legitimize or justify content control and promote these information security norms. However, one thing that we do see, especially in the European Union, is an increased securitization of internet content, especially when we look at hate speech and disinformation. So this constitutes two problems. One, like these labels like hate speech and disinformation are used to increasingly regulate the internet. So fake news is not always about disinformation, right? Like a lot of fake news is just to generate advertisement revenue, to like pull as many people towards your website, whereas disinformation is about the deliberate spread of content to deceive. And if we look at the debate that's going on in the European right now, fake news is often seen as this disinformation issue that's about disrupting the elections, but most of fake news is not what that is. So the increased securitization of seeing content as a threat really limits what could potentially limit freedom of speech online in Europe, and I think we have to be very careful with these kinds of arguments. And the second problem is that it creates an opportunity for authoritarian states to develop more national and international regulations with regard to content. So we saw that there were some authoritarian regimes that when the Network Enforcement Act in Germany or the NetzDG was implemented, used that as a justification for national policies. Furthermore, the global narrative sometimes is also moving towards the direction that we should counter terrorist narratives, for instance. So we should be very careful, I feel, in the European Union with using these kind of narratives. So I think that global cooperation is very unlikely in the future when it comes down to content. But we see a lot of regional developments, and I think this will be an ongoing thing, whether it's in the European Union, the Council of Europe, or the Shanghai Cooperation Organization. And I think that we have to be very careful with securitizing internet content if we want to protect freedom of speech online.
Okay, thank you very much. So from the responses you have heard already, very different visions on how to regulate and what the problem is. And I would like to basically organize our small round table discussion here among across three cross-cutting issues and go a step back before we come back to how to regulate. So the first is I would like to talk a little bit more what is the framing here, you know, what is the problem? Why is online defamation a problem, or why maybe freedom of speech should be considered as more important? We have heard in the contributions, you know, people are balancing it differently. Then secondly, also as part of that, you know, what are really the effects that we are talking about, that we are trying to resist or combat with these suggestions for governing and regulating, and then to come back to the different visions of what to do about it and discuss them a bit. So in terms of what is the framing here, you know, I think I wouldn't want too much to insist on the different understandings of defamation maybe, but more about, if we talk about defamation, hate speech, online harassment, more what makes it different online from offline. You know, and is that a different phenomenon that we are talking about? Does it need different measures to deal with it? What are the effects of it when it comes down to the targeted groups, but what are also the effects for public debate, right? So maybe let's start with what is the difference between online defamation and online hate speech as compared to offline? Is there a difference? And does it make the problem, you know, does it change the problem that we are talking about? So who would like to start?
I'll start.
Yeah.
Well, scope and speed is a big issue. When we talk about YouTube, for example, YouTube gets 1.8 billion visitors monthly. So a viral video on YouTube that is defamatory, that has hate speech, can reach a lot more people. And with that kind of scale, it's difficult for any one company to accurately and very rapidly remove this content. Once removed, of course, it can be reposted. So companies face an uphill battle in trying to identify this, trying to remove this. As well, we have a business model that is oriented towards serving viral content, whether that's great viral content with amusing cat videos or horrible viral content of hate speech. And we know that there are algorithms designed to serve up more of what you've already seen. So if you've seen one video that is full of hateful, violent content, next in the queue is a video just like that or worse. So those are two issues.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Who would like to add, Anna?
I would say that if we take individual level, we should understand that we're talking about real people, real lives, real concerns. And as I just mentioned, some cases might be so serious that they lead to suicide, for instance. And it is not only the case of China, of course. In the Western media, we often hear about that. Sometimes the systematic hate comments can silence certain people. It is another issue whether or not it's been done on purpose and what is the purpose of that, but it is being done, and if the general public is not has a very low level of awareness, legal awareness, for instance, so it's very difficult to know how individuals should protect themselves in front of defamatory content.
And, yep. And on top of that, you also have, in terms of the speed and the scope, is that the, you know, that social media often lends itself to pile-ons, so that you know, one person saying one thing can, even if it, and this isn't quite defamation, but it can lead to the destruction of lives. One person saying one stupid thing online, which, you know, if so, you heard that passing on the street, you just say, oh, what an idiot. It can lead to essentially to the destruction of their professional and personal lives if they're essentially, and the loss of jobs. And it's happened in the past. And so essentially it weaponizes popular opinion in a sense.
And then if I could relate a bit to the responses to this speed and the scope of this content being spread, I think from a European perspective, what we do is we have these measures like the Network Enforcement Act or the Code of Conduct, where we say, okay, now companies have to remove it within 24 hours because we know how destructive this content might be, maybe with regard to terrorism or extremism. But then we make these companies responsible for very quickly removing this content, right? And the question is, do you really want that to be? Because we know companies can probably not make a good assessment within 24 hours. There are often no appeal mechanisms. There's no transparency about how they make their decisions. So I think, of course, we have this problem of speed and scope, but to say then companies have to remove this content within 24 hours might not be the best reaction to them.
So we have been speaking about speed and scale. So what about anonymity? You know, because, I mean, one of the problems that is documented on the internet is it's hard to pursue online defamation because often it's also very difficult to identify the source of it. The other fact is you write on the internet and you don't see the person that you talk to, and there are psychological studies that in a way say that this makes people, you know, to be more offensive, or it reduces the kind of restrictions that they would put on themselves. So does it invite people, you know, to disseminate much more discriminatory content? And if we go beyond the individuals that are targeted, how can we situate, you know, the statistics that show that discriminatory speech in the internet has been really exploding over the last year? So there are studies in Germany that show that on online platforms and the number of anti-Semitic statements have tripled over a period of 10 years. You know, there are other, you know, analysis that show in the context of the migration debate, you know, hate speech and defamatory statements on social groups like migrants, refugees, and so on have been really increasing rapidly in number and spread. And I guess you have similar statistics from Pew Center in the US. So, I mean, the one question is, does anonymity foster this? The other question is, what does that with public debate more broadly beyond the groups and the individuals that are targeted here?
Well, anonymity is both absolutely essential and a real problem. So it's absolutely essential for those groups and individuals who are marginalized, are vulnerable, who are speaking about sensitive, difficult topics. So dissident groups, pro-democracy groups, people speaking about sexual health, LGBTQ communities. So it's absolutely essential for groups. So I think we have to recognize the value of anonymity in certain contexts and the protective layer that it adds for often very marginalized, vulnerable people. And of course, anonymity can be a problem, and people who want to promote very hateful views, who want to act like trolls, who want to deliberately damage and hurt people, are going to hide behind a shield of anonymity. But simply stripping anonymity from everyone isn't an answer and isn't an effective strategy.
Yeah, and along those lines too, I mean, anonymity, you know, can contribute to people feeling like they can say anything that they want online, but I believe also studies have shown that people will say anything they want online even if their name is attached to it, because I think the key thing is the distance, the fact that you're not actually looking at another person, you're looking at your computer screen, and so it's depersonalized, and so it's much easier to, you know, play the bedroom warrior and say horrible things about anybody if you don't actually have to look them in the eye. So yeah, so getting rid of anonymity won't be a problem. But the other thing too is that, and again, we'll bring it back to the way that the social media are structured, is that these platforms aren't neutral. These platforms aren't essentially neutral playing fields. Is that they're set up, there's rules governing them, and there's rules governing, as I think has been suggested a couple of times, governing what gets picked up, what gets put to the fore, and so on and so forth. So that there's an individual role to play to be thought of as well. But it's also very important to think about how these companies are setting up, how they're setting up their platform.
All right, so several years ago, the Chinese government introduced a regulation known as real name registration to tackle the problem of anonymity, obviously. So users are registered now with their real names. Of course, they might hide under the nickname or nickname online, but you can trace back the nickname to the real person. Well, the implications of that are twofold, probably, one of which is increased self-censorship of course. And the second would be the change in the way people express themselves online. So the shift from more daring, explicit expression toward more implicit, tacit expression. But it still exists, even knowing that your real name is known to the authorities.
And I think if I look at the debate that's being held in the European Union, if we talk about encryption, it's almost always in the context of terrorism and extremism and people trying to hide their crimes. But we should not forget that the same technology, just like Natasha said, is helping human rights activists, it's helping journalists, like it's aiding civil society as well, right? And just to say we ban the technology, that might have very negative effects on freedom of speech online. And indeed, there will be huge chilling effects. Just this idea that you have a right to anonymity also fosters this idea that you're freer to think and that you're free to express yourself. And this is something I think we don't want to lose just because some groups might use the same technology for different purposes.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so I hear a clear vote that removing anonymity is not the solution here, but it's more about moderating or setting environments, you know, that foster different types of more respectful discussion. So let's then move back to the suggestions that you made already in terms of regulating or governing. So, I mean, Blaine, you had this idea that a kind of, I mean, I understand it like a globally orchestrated but nationally regulated system, yeah? And maybe we can discuss that together with Anna's point on that there needs to be global cooperation to keep China, and would extend that probably to Russia, in the debate. So do they leave them there? I know them. I know by heart now what I want to say. Do they oppose each other? Or can they be integrated? So maybe we can start out then and then we involve the others in the discussion as well.
Sure, I'll start. For me, it comes, the basic point that I kind of try to keep in the back of my head is that the rules are going to be made by somebody. In a sense, the idea of free speech, there's always going to be boundaries on what is considered free speech and how speech is dealt with. So the real question is who is going to make these rules and who is best suited or who or what group is best suited to do that? And given the differences amongst amongst societies and amongst countries, and given the fact that we don't have, for instance, a kind of a world democratic government, it seems that the best level would have to be almost necessarily have to be at the country level, or amongst groups of like-minded countries. So, that's for reasons of democratic accountability for those countries that are democratic. But it also is kind of it recognizes the fact that the issues that we see with for instance with countries like China. Very much being very strongly controlling of speech and how other countries deal with speech. It's not really about the internet, or it's not about any digital technologies. It's more reflective of the underlying society itself. So your rules that you're going to have are going to reflect your underlying society. And the question is, how do you essentially set up a world where you kind of take that into account? And the other thing too is that the issue of moderating and dealing with these issues, it's an issue, a question of scale. And like I said in my comments, it's unfair and it's kind of pointless to expect one company based in one country to come up with common rules for 2 billion people. Now you can get rid of that, or you can kind of deal with that issue of scale if you bring it down. If you have essentially kind of like the idea of what Eli Noam calls a federated internet of companies or of social media platforms that are able to be interoperable with other countries, but subject primarily to domestic regulation.
I think cooperation is extremely important, and China has spoke out five rules of cooperation, not rules, but five basic principles of international cooperation when it comes to the regulation of internet, international internet. And those are national sovereignty on the first place, non-interference into national into internal affairs, non-militarization of cyberspace, peaceful resolution of international disputes in cyberspace, and international cooperation. So I believe that China wants cooperation. Now it's very important to think of how we cooperate with each other, how we cooperate with China in particular. I believe that rather than setting a very firm number of rules on the notions of basic notions and norms that we offer to China for consideration, a cooperation on more micro level between countries on international level would be more productive. And that probably from the long-term perspective that will probably that will be gradually that will gradually form the common framework of norms and practices.
Mm-hmm. So would that go hand in hand with what, can that be part of a federated system, or are you talking about something different?
Well, it's not up to me to decide, so yeah. Yeah, I think it's important to begin. It's important to start the cooperation first. Rather than, I mean, we have the meeting of United Nations group of governmental experts, and China was appeared to be rather reluctant to cooperate within this framework. So existing frameworks seem to be a problem right now. So the idea is to start cooperation probably within different frameworks, and but cooperation is needed. There is no.
Could I? I'm just curious. So what do you mean by micro-cooperation?
Micro-cooperation, I would say, micro-cooperation would be cooperation between banks, on individual level as well, between companies, between probably, if you go up to the state level, ministries. So where you have a very practical cooperation on very specific issues. So first you have to identify its issues and then set a framework for solving these issues through cooperation with agents who are involved in these issues.
Mm-hmm. Okay, Danielle, is the European Union practicing what Lane is suggesting?
If you look at some areas, not necessarily the European Union, but the Council of Europe, they work a lot on cybercrime, for instance. So you see in some areas, especially more the security areas, there is this more or less type of cooperation, I would say. And also there, specific ministry and police agencies, they cooperate on this level. Because I would think, like, on an international level, like, this would not work. I think there are two main issues there. I think first is which type of norms are we talking about, and the second is which type of institutions are we talking about. And if you look at the type of norms, the US wants to regulate as little as possible, and then China has this norm of information security and really about regulating content, and this is so diverging that this will never be regulated, or at least not in the coming decade, I would say. The same what we saw in the United Nations group of governmental experts. They did not reach an agreement. It was a failure this year. And then the second issue is the design of institutions. So what you see that more democratic states, they want multi-stakeholder institutions, like include non-state actors in decision-making, whereas more authoritarian states would say, no, we want a governmental led, like an intergovernmental model. Preferably under UN, under UN rule, right? So I think that this is so divergent that it would not lead to cooperation.
Just out of curiosity, do you think it's possible, though, that, I mean, this is the conversation, I think, though, that has to happen, I mean, I agree with you that, you know, for instance, that the United States and certainly the U.S. internet companies aren't interested in that. But I think that, you know, we're seeing increasing government involvement, not just in authoritarian countries, but straight across the board in pretty much all areas related to kind of like digital development and internet governance. And in my mind, and I think you also see kind of interest, you know, increasing critiques, not just from authoritarian states of the multi-stakeholder model. So I think what you'd have to see essentially is a move towards that kind of European idea, towards the idea that President Macron put forward of having state involvement. And I think if you had that, then that would kind of create the groundwork for having some kind of increased cooperation among states.
So indeed, with Macron's speech, it was interesting. So Macron gave a speech during the Internet Governance Forum, and you saw that the discourse, like from a European perspective, really changed. It was kind of a tipping point. So Macron certainly talked about like there's such a thing as a truth and a non-truth, and it was very provocative in a way. So I do think, especially with the European elections coming up, that Europe is, like, it was always already between those two models, but it will now act upon this, right? It will start to regulate more and more. And maybe it is a middle ground, but I would say still that a lot of European countries are still afraid of the rhetorics of controlling content by authoritarian states, and I would say that is still a step too far.
Okay, before we go into discussion, I would like to put one point maybe to Natasha, because we have been hearing now a surprising level of, you know, state regulation of the internet. So what about civil society, and what more kind of you know, down to the ground positive initiatives that show you can do it differently?
Yeah, definitely. Civil society plays a huge and very important role. So I'm thinking of groups in the United States like Electronic Frontier Foundation, in Europe, the Digital Rights Initiative. So these groups are incredibly valuable for identifying problems, for monitoring both governments and tech companies, for suggesting solutions, so for advocating specific legislative amendments or for highlighting problematic legislation. And they have to be involved. So some of these groups have highly technical people. They are very well versed on areas like the encryption debate or intellectual property or various other areas of internet governance. So involving them at a technical level and gathering information from these groups is really valuable. I think what's important to remember too is that these groups can't operate alone. Certainly, they're very overwhelmed, and they have a number of different issues to deal with. So we can't simply always rely on, in the North American context, the EFF to raise the problems that we need to deal with. So certainly, relying on these groups alone isn't the problem, but making sure they're at the right table. So what we've seen in the internet governance context is governments sitting down with some of the big tech companies and deciding the rules of the game, setting out the regulatory framework, and then inviting the public and civil society groups at the end of the day and saying, what do you think? And certainly, if we really are interested in multi-stakeholder governance, instead of just paying homage to it, if we're interested in true public debate, inviting these groups and, you know, representative civil society groups at the beginning of the regulatory discussion rather than at the end would be extremely useful.
So thanks. I think regulation is one thing. So what are really good best practice examples where you can show it's not just about removing content, but maybe creating an environment in which people discuss with more respect? Any positive example?
I'll think of a positive that turned into a negative, because that's the world we live in now. So one of my favorite websites is the AV Club. It's a pop culture website, American pop culture website. And for years, it had absolutely the best discussing community. So, you know, it was one of those sites where you go to read the articles and basically almost skip over the article and go straight to the comments because they're that inventive. And it really did create, you know, the word community gets overused a lot. So I'm going to overuse it again, and it created a community. And I think it did that because essentially of a little bit of kind of self-enforcement, but also, I believe, you know, some strong moderation by the people running the website, which I think is probably the key one of the key things that you can do if you want to actually kind of create a good space online. Is, you know, you can't leave it up to algorithms as a cost-cutting measure, which is usually what it is, but, you know, people actually have to be involved, and you have to, you know, this stuff takes time, it takes money, it takes people. So that's the happy side. The sad side is that I think about a year ago it got bought by Univision, and they changed the comments sections so that it will, first of all, they changed the platform that they were using to make it much more much harder to use and much harder to have like kind of threaded comments, which caused a problem. But what they also did is they essentially merged all the comment sections across a whole slew of different popular culture websites. And so, in other words, what you had essentially is kind of like a very kind of like nice, intelligent, witty community got diluted, and you had people essentially doing drive-by comments and really lowering the level of discourse. So I think that's kind of what that tells me is that, you know, that creating a good platform that not only keeps away kind of hate speech and defamation, but actually kind of raises the bar as far as conversation goes, takes a lot of hard work. But it'll all be undone if you don't put in the right rules in the right way.
Okay, thank you very much. So I thank you very much, the panelists. We will now open up to the discussion here in the audience, which means also we say goodbye and thank you for watching us through the live stream.